Hello and welcome to worship. I'm Grace, I'm one of the Nid Valley ministers, and it's good to be with you this week. You may be wondering why I'm sitting in my garden on a swing, which is very exciting, if a bit creepy, and holding a cross. And it's because, wait for it, this week is the second week in our preaching series on the Methodist way of life. And this week we're thinking about learning and caring. And one of the things that I love about learning and about caring is that we can do it in so many different ways. And we all have different learning styles. There are different ways that people learn. Now in church, we quite often self-select because most of the learning and teaching that we do is auditory. I talk, you listen. That's but only one of the ways that people learn. The other ways that people learn are visually, by looking at things, kinesthetically, by moving, and by playing and touching things and moving things around. And later on in the service, Ruth's going to talk to us about godly play and how that's a kinesthetic and visual way of learning. We also learn auditory, listening, kinesthetically, moving, visually by looking at things, and through reading and writing, through copying out, and through writing about and exploring in text. And so with those four ways of learning, we all learn differently. And one of the beautiful things about church moving forward is that we can reclaim some of those different ways of learning together. But of course the question is, why do we learn? Why do we as Christians need to learn? Well, we need to learn more about who God is. We need to go deeper in our relationship with God. And just like when you fall in love with somebody, you want to learn everything that there is about them. And you'll do that in various different ways, by listening to them, by talking to them, by drawing sketches of your beloved, by writing about them to your friends, by following their Facebook feed and seeing what they say. Loads of ways that we learn about each other. So it is with God, and ways that we connect with the Word of God. And that's what we're going to be thinking about today as we worship God together. Shall we pray? Amazing God, you are awesome. Your creation is incredible, and we praise you. We thank you for the beauty and diversity of your creation. We thank you that we are not all made the same, but that we are called to be together, to learn from one another, to learn more of you as we worship, as we learn, as we care together. Lord, we thank you that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, that we are made in your image, that we are created to learn about you in different ways and to share that love and that learning with one another. Amen. I have to say that for me, learning and caring are so intertwined, because the fifth way that we learn is, and there is a posh word for this, but it's from one another. We're social beings. We are designed to be together, to rub off one another. We're herd animals, and just like herd animals, we'll learn together what is and isn't good and what is and isn't bad. So we as humans learn from one another. If I asked you to tell me how you learnt about what God's like, you'd probably look at me and go, because we learn it when we're in community together, when we care for each other. We learn almost by osmosis. We soak it in from those around us who are walking with us in our journey of faith. And I'm really excited this morning that we're going to think about some of the very different ways that we can share in that old, old story. So let's sing.
Happy are those who do not follow the advice of the wicked, or take the path that sinners tread, or sit in the seat of scoffers. But their delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law they meditate day and night. They are like trees planted by streams of water, which yield their fruit in its season, and their leaves do not wither. In all that they do, they prosper. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish.
Meditate on my laws day and night, says God. Blessed is the one who does that. But in the chaos, in the busyness of life with things happening, maybe we're not sit-stillers. Maybe we are people who struggle to hear that, to stop and listen and read quietly in all of the busyness that's happening around us. Blessed are those who meditate on my word day and night. But how do we do that? How do we meditate on God's word day and night? Well, in the next section of our service, we're going to hear from some people with some different ways of meditating on the word of God, thinking about those learning styles from the beginning, thinking about the way that each of us can start to tune out the noise and chaos of our world and tune in to who God is. And as we do that, we'll think more about how learning and caring are connected together and connected to our walk with God.
Remember being introduced to godly play for the first time about 20 years ago. I was sitting on the floor of a church hall somewhere in West Yorkshire. I didn't really know what to expect, but had come to this day because a friend had organised it, and I wanted to support them. The storyteller opened the sandbag that was the desert. Well, a part of the desert, because we couldn't get the whole desert into the room. They told me as they ran their hands through the sand that the desert is a dangerous place and people don't go there unless they have to. And they reminded me that many of the stories of the Bible take place in the desert. They then began to tell the story of Abraham and Sarai, using these small figures that stepped through the desert, leaving their footprints in the sand. I travelled with Sarah and Abraham along the banks of the river Euphrates from Ur to Haran, where they settled for a while. As we travelled, the storyteller explained that Abraham and Sarai came from a place with many gods, for each tree, the river, the sun, and the moon, and the rocks. But on their journey, Abraham and Sarai discovered that all of God was everywhere. They didn't need to take God with them, as God was everywhere. I felt tears in my eyes as the storyteller placed Abraham between their hands and said Abraham was someone who came so close to God that God came close to him, and Abraham knew what God wanted him to do. It's quite a long story and we didn't touch on much of it, but it does include them changing their names, settling by the oaks of Mamre, the birth of Isaac, and the death and the burial of Sarah. The story ended like this. Old Abraham was now very full of years. He died and was buried in a cave beside Sarai. Then Isaac and Rebekah had children, and their children had children, and those children had children. This went on for thousands and thousands of years, until your grandmothers and grandfathers had children, then your mothers and fathers had children. And now you are part of that great family, which has become as many as the stars in the sky and the grains of sand in the desert. The storyteller then sat back on their heels. "Don't stop," I thought. They looked round and asked the wondering questions that I came to learn were an integral part of godly play. "I wonder what part of the story you liked best. I wonder what part is the most important. I wonder where you are in the story, or what part of the story is about you." There was a silence in the room for some time. I wondered if, like me, others were afraid to speak because they weren't sure that they could without crying. It was honestly the most moving telling of that story I've ever heard. I was there in the story, and so was my granny. How beautiful. I hadn't been practicing godly play for long when I had another experience that convinced me further of the value of the visual. I told the story of the Good Samaritan to a group of children. During the story, the thieves that set upon the man were placed under some rocks by the side of the road, so that they were no longer visually a part of the story. One of the wondering questions was who was the neighbour to the injured man. We talked about it and established that it wasn't the priest or the Levite, but the Samaritan. And then one little boy, one who could misbehave at times, to say the least, said, "What about the man under those rocks? Who's his neighbour?" I have to say that wasn't a question I'd particularly considered in this context before. But because he'd seen them, because he'd seen that man hidden under the rock or behind the rock, he thought about them. I suppose the bottom line is that it reminded me of the value of the visual for some people. Not everyone learns better or understands better that way, but many do. And I think it's something that we've neglected a bit. Playing with the story, entering into the story, putting ourselves into the story can be so valuable. Jesus told stories and used visual images that people would have understood. I end with some of the words from the end of the story of the Good Samaritan, albeit in a different context. "Go and do likewise."
So how then do we become like a tree planted by still water? How do we take what we've learnt about learning styles and apply it and respond to Psalm 1? Well, I think to start with, we need to think about translation, because when I say meditation, you probably think about going away to a quiet place and either clearing your mind or silently reading scripture. But of course, our word doesn't directly translate into and from the Hebrew for meditation, hagar, which, if it sounds like a dove cooing, is because that's exactly the image it's supposed to conjure up. Like one, blessed is the one who hagars day and night on your word. Who coos like a dove. That's the other Hebrew word. You would say, oh, that dove is hagaring. Well, not quite that, because the grammar's not there. It's also the word for a bear eating its dinner, the noise it makes, that chomp, chomp, chomp as it enjoys eating. Hagar, as you chew day and night on the scripture, as you coo like a dove over the scripture. And in Jewish practice, hagar, meditation, is speaking aloud the words of God. It's a whole body experience. As you breathe in Jesus and breathe out care and love. So as you hagar on scripture, you can do that with your whole body, as you reflect, as you dig deeper. And of course, like a bear eating its dinner, these things are often best done in community, together, as we discuss scripture, as we breathe in Jesus and breathe out love. We learn and we care, in and out, with physical playing, with listening, of course, sometimes, but of course in the church we've got so hung up on scripture being listened to, on our learning being about sitting and listening. And for some people that's wonderful, and obviously as church we self-select, don't we? Those who are good at listening come to church. So more of us are auditory learners. Hagar, chewing on, cooing like a dove over the word of God, that it may feed us, fill us, so that we breathe in Jesus and breathe out love. Is that by writing icons, reading and writing, copying out scripture as the ancient monastic tradition did, writing poems based on scripture? Is it about looking, seeing pictures, building, playing with, hearing. One of the things I do is listen to scripture as I walk. I have podcasts with people reading scripture as we dwell on the word of God, as we breathe in Jesus and we breathe out love. We don't say, how can I apply this scripture to my life, in the same way as we don't say, how can I apply this letter from my friend to life? Instead, we respond in love to what we receive. Hagar, the ancient practice of muttering under our breath words of scripture, words of hope, of talking in community, of chewing on the word of God in a whole manner of ways. And as we do that, as we meditate, Hagar, on the good news, we can breathe in Jesus, breathe out love, breathe in learning, breathe out caring as a way of life, so that we might be like trees planted by still waters.
Be changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me to your side, and as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Unveil my eyes, let me see you face to face, the knowledge of your love as you live in me. Lord, renew my mind as your will unfolds in my life, in living every day by the power of your love. Hold me close, let your love surround. To your side, and as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle, and I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Let your love surround me. Bring me near. Draw me to your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the I will soar with you. Your spirit leads me on in the power of your love.
Hello, my name is Lydia, and I have learnt Makaton in lockdown, primarily to help communicate with my godchildren, but also to help enhance worship, because there's something wonderful about using your body to worship as well. Today's service has been all about learning and caring. And I'm going to teach you now how to say the grace in Makaton. I sign with my right hand primarily, and that's my dominant hand in all the signs I do. It's okay if you sign with your left hand if you're left-handed, but I just wanted to draw attention to the fact that God, when we're signing about God, is on our dominant side, because our strength comes from God. So our help comes from God, and help is the same sign as grace. So we say, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that's like his crucified fingers, the love of God, and the fellowship or friendship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore, which means forever. Amen. And hopefully you'll remember those signs as we'll finish the service with the grace too. And our prayers of intercession today are responsive. And we say together, loving God, help us to listen to you. Loving God, help us to listen to you. Caring, loving God, your Son taught that we should love you with our whole being, and that we should love our neighbours as ourselves. Loving God, help us to listen to you. Help me to love you and love my neighbours. Teach me to care for myself, cultivating the gifts you have given to me and looking after my own well-being so that I might care for others. Loving God, help us to listen to you. Help me to learn more of you, of my faith and the world around me each day. Loving God, help us to listen to you. Help me to pray for the things you already know, for the needs of the world, the needs of your people, the needs of the church, my own needs, and the needs of those I love. Loving God, help us to listen to you. Accept these prayers in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen.
I hope that this week's worship has been helpful and uplifting for you. And I wonder if you can guess what my learning style is. probably judging on the number of different locations we've been to as I've produced this service, you'll realise that I'm a kinesthetic learner. I learn by moving, by touching, by manipulating objects. I wonder what your learning style is. I wonder whether you are the typical church-going auditory learner that you learn by listening and absorbing. Or maybe like me, you're a learner who learns through movement. Or one of those wonderful people who learns by writing, by reading, by reflecting back. Maybe you're a visual learner, you learn through pictures and images. Whatever sort of learner you are, I wonder what church would look like if we embraced the learning that you're comfortable with and the learning that challenges and stretches you, so that together we can all breathe in Jesus and breathe out love and care. And so I leave you with the blessing.
May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.